Did I have the rams last time you were here?
The rams? I don't know what a ram is.
These are rams.
These ones?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
I know it's changed. Last time you were here, this whole entire area right here was a sand bed.
Oh, yeah, that's right. And there was somebody that was saying that you had some kind of crabs up in here?
I had a dwarf Mexican crayfish.
Oh, did the crayfish do any damage?
Not really. The only problems I've had out of him is that maybe every once in a while he will dig up a plant and it'll float up to the top and then I have to replant it. What I would tell everyone, all crayfish, if you plan on having a planted tank, then I probably wouldn't advise it because they're going to be a pain in your butt. You know, they like to burrow and make like little territories and make little caves, and they move stuff around. So if you like having, you know, your aquascape stay the same and stay kind of normal, then I wouldn't advise getting one. It was a mistake.
And also, I had made ask you a question about if you were running carbon, and everybody's like, well, CO2 is carbon, but...
Well, there's two... CO2 is carbon, that's correct. But it's a different type of carbon. It's the carbon that cells use to build their walls. And that's what enables the plants to grow faster. There's carbon in everything. The carbon that I was discussing is actual charcoal.
Mm-hmm.
And when you put charcoal in a tank, it's very porous. And what carbon does is it sucks your fertilizers and the different nutrients and the stuff that you're trying to put into the tank for your plants. So when I said I'm not running carbon, I meant that I'm not putting actual carbon pads or carbon granules in the back of the filter. You don't even really need to put carbon in a tank with plants because they're going to do the same thing anyway. They eat that stuff to grow. So that's what I meant.
Because that's what I meant too, like mechanical filtration carbon, that's, you know,
yeah,
not dosing carbon. You're still dosing CO2 into this tank? Or?
Yes.
It's grown quite a bit.
Yeah, the only thing is that these top plants, I have water lettuce up here before, and this large duckweed, which still looks cool, it's taken over, and it killed the water lettuce that I had because it outcompeted it. But I lost what I was about to say.
Still very, really cool. To me, this is all really, really neat.
Oh, but I remember my train of thought now. This large duckweed is growing so thick that it's kind of blocking out a lot of the light, which is maybe yellowing some of the leaves on this Brazilian sword that I have down here. And I got some big surprises in the back.
check it out.
In the back room. And when I say I have some big surprises, I have some really huge mammoth surprises back there, which is going to be kind of fun.
Let's go check it out.
But this tank is doing good. I have no losses. I just changed some of the aquascape and I put in a few new plants in here to try to fill it in a little bit. And I'm trying to grow a carpet, but I haven't had very much luck with that.
And which cube is this? The Innovative Marine?
This is the Innovative Marine 40. The 45 would not clear this cube right here. I get confused a lot on my videos. I say 45 and then one day I say 40. But it's actually a 40.
So if you're looking at one of these are really nice. And I like the all-in-one design.
Yeah, just don't buy this light right here.
No, don't buy this light?
No. You can do a freshwater plant tank. This is a very, very nice light. And I know a lot of people are going to give me a bunch of crap about this. but for the controller, for the light, for the gooseneck, everything was about $420.
And that's not even the tank.
No, it had nothing to do with the tank. the tank was cheaper than the light. But if you've seen the last video, those par 38 lights that I had, that you see the clamp lights, please go out and get one of those.
Okay.
They're $60, and you can put them on a timer, and they work just as good. It's just not, in my opinion, it's not worth it. No, it wasn't worth the money. I feel like I wanted to go with something that looked designer and make a really high class looking tank in the living room with all the bells and whistles. But if I could do it over again, I would buy one of the light bulbs that I cut in the back. Cut in the back room.
All right, let's go check out the other.
Which one is this one?
This is the new one.
Oh, that's the okay.
This one's not working out.
I did kind of see you.
So you were doing a little trimming, or?
Yeah, I had some problems. There was a
crap.
Oh yeah, the shrimp population in here has exploded.
Awesome.
I have thousands of them now.
Yeah, you sure do.
They are everywhere. And you know, the beautiful thing about these shrimp is you can sell them and you can make a lot of money from them.
Have you thought of that, or is this a strictly hobby for you?
It's just strictly hobby. I'd rather just give them away to friends. I mean, I'd rather save my friends money than go give them to a pet store for 10 cents
exactly.
For each one, and then turn around and sell them to $2. And
this is so cool, man. The last time when we got here, it was you were just starting it up, but man, this is established.
Yeah, the Blixia japonica right here, the real frilly plants, they weren't growing, but now they're starting to grow. So first thing, I wanted to talk about a problem that's caused me a little bit of issues, and that's why the tank kind of looks so barren right here and also back there. And that's, if you see right here, these right here, these are like runners, and they're what they came from was I had some real frilly plants right here that grew up that look really, really cool. As a matter of fact, I have one left that I haven't been able to eradicate. And I'll take you over to it just to show the viewers what it looks like if you do planted tanks. And I highly recommend that you stay away from this plant if I can find it. Where is it at? We're going to find it in a minute. Just be patient. I seen it here the other day.
Shrimp are freaking cool.
Yeah, they're everywhere. Check this out. There's one right here. It's a huge one. All right, you can keep talking. Let me just try to locate.
So here it is.
I found it. Okay. This plant right here.
That's cool, though.
Yeah, they look really beautiful, and in a group they look really beautiful, but. What this plant does is it basically overtakes the tank.
Zinnia, right?
It's worse than zinnia. It's 50 times worse than anything I've ever seen. These little, if you see these little nodes right here, like these little nodes,
yeah.
It spreads off hundreds of thousands of these, and they wrap all into the plants, right?
Right.
And then they go around them and around it. See, there's a whole bunch of it right here. I'm still getting rid of it. I've been working on it for a couple of days now. But they wrap around all the plants and then tangle them up. And they keep them from growing up. Then they grow on top of them. Then they spread up. Then
they like over here too.
Yeah.
Right?
And then they send roots. They send roots down into the ground. And then the roots go around the rest of the plants. And they smother the plants. So I had the colony was right here. The mother colony was here. So I've uprooted them and taken them out, and I've planted it with these red plants right here.
Those are so nice.
So basically, it's these plants right here is what I'm replanting them with. These red ones. And I'm going to trim them and kind of fill in this area and let them grow up. And then the problem will be solved.
So is that, I guess that plant is only it's only in this tank right here, right?
Or yeah, I will never purchase that plant again. I will never put it, it's, you know what, people are going to say you can have that plant, but you just have to, you have to monitor it. But some weeks I'll work 60 hours a week sometimes, but you know, most time I work 40, but there's times when I have to work 60 hours a week, and I don't have the time every day to do maintenance. I can do it once a week.
Right.
But when once a week comes, those things operate extremely fast, especially with the amount of CO2 that's in this tank that's being pumped into here. So it was overtaking the tank, so it was time to chunk it out. And you know what? It was honestly my favorite looking plant in here.
It's really nice, yeah.
I hated to do it, but yeah, it's just like the stuff grows. It's growing everywhere. It's all in.
It's like a net.
Yeah, it's just like a net, exactly. And you see how it's latched onto these plants and is pulling these glossostigmas up, and that's the name of this particular plant right here.
Do not buy that plant.
Buy glossostigma. It's nice. It's a good carpeting plant, but forgive me. I can't remember the name of the plant, and I need to. So I don't buy it by mistake again.
But there's a lot of freshwater planted tank people that can go ahead and leave it in the comments.
Yeah, if you can identify the plant in the comments. I just can't remember what the name of it is right now. I can look back on it, look at my order, and see what it was, and maybe update it later if I have the time, and I'll let everybody know.
And just so everybody knows, Kevin does have a YouTube page, and he updates it pretty regularly, so I'll put a link card so you guys can click that and subscribe.
Yeah, the name of the page is Kevin Wilson and Everything Aquariums.
And this is a lot of aquariums. So.
Yeah, I have quite a few aquariums. Although I had started this brackish tank right here on the back.
Uh-huh. Just get a close up on this lights, because there was a lot of buzz about your lights.
Oh yeah, I did a video on the lights for them. Okay. If you want to know about my lights and where to get them and what they're called, it's also on my YouTube page, so you can check that out. But just to give you a quick explanation, these are LED PAR 38 bulbs, 6500 Kelvin spectrum. You got to get the right spectrum. You can't just go out and order a Cree LED PAR 38 light. You have to get the correct color temperature. So it's 6500 Kelvin is the correct color temperature. And then these fixtures right here are sold by Reef Radiance on LED. And for people who are into reefing, they have PAR 38 reef bulbs. You don't have to get them from Reef Radiance. You can actually look up some reviews and find the best ones that work. There's some really good ones out there. But the beautiful thing about this is, guys, if you don't want to spend, you know, like I have Aqua Illuminations, and I know Mike has a really, really expensive fixtures over his tanks. But for budget reefers and people with not a lot of money that want to get into the hobby, if you want to start out and get something that's actually going to grow your coral and keep your tank alive, go ahead and pick up one of these mounts. Make sure it's the correct one. There are a lot of them, and some of them are short, like this one right here. You see how short it is? It's not going to really be able to do the whole span of your tank.
Right.
That's why this isn't even turned on. So these right here have the ability, they're goosenecks, have the ability to swivel right here. So you can move them up. This one does not. They're both the same length and height, but there's no way to turn this. You see, there's no way to angle this down like you can with this knob right here. You just turn this knob and the light bulb goes up or down, and that's what you want. So check them out on Amazon and make sure you get the right one. And then the PAR 38 bulbs, they have them for reefs, and they have them in royal blue. They have royal blue, yellow, red, hyper red, green. They also have UV included, and the whites. So you get everything that you would normally get in like a radion fixture or another fixture, and the bulbs run like $70. So you got $40 on this fixture right here, and $80. That's $120. And if you're doing a cube tank that's maybe, I want to say, if you're doing like a 24 or a 30 gallon tank, maybe stretching it a 40 gallon tank, you can easily do a 40 gallon tank. Let's see here. Let's measure this out real quick. Let's see what you could do with that. Let's see the spread on one light. So we'll look at this light. So right now this light is covering, and I'll turn it off. Just turn this light. Okay. So we're getting about that much spread.
Maybe a 20.
So probably about a 20 gallon tank, possibly a 30. You could possibly do a 30 if you do most of your rock work in the right near the rocks and down here. And you know what? There's still some light over here. Let me take that off.
Is that a marine lamp?
No, this is just a fluval.
Oh, fluval. Okay.
It was over here on this tank, but this tank is just not working out. So yeah, Mike was right. You could probably do a nano tank with that. And if you wanted to do, I would say a 40 gallon tank, you need two of them. But still $200 for a 40 gallon tank is still pretty affordable.
Yeah, 40 gallon tank, the dollar per gallon on Petco. But I would say two of these lights. Start off with one and get the second one.
Absolutely.
But these shrimp, man, I like those little shrimp.
Yeah, they're cool, man. They're real hardy too, and they breed, man. They breed like
so.
Like
you didn't
crazy.
So you didn't do anything. You just kept everything stable for them to breed, or
oh yeah, cherry shrimp really don't need much, man. They eat dead plant matter and dead leaves. They're like a cleanup crew, and when I feed the fish, they eat the flake food. They're not like high needs. Some of the other fish that they have, not fish, but shrimp, like, you got, the Japanese bee shrimp and, more of the high end type of shrimp. They need, you need to put like acorn, little mini adder cones in there, and they need vegetables and certain types of stuff. And then also the only thing I can recommend is that you make sure you have calcium. Don't put calcium in your water like you do in a reef tank. Just put just a little bit, or you can get some aragonite crushed coral.
Okay.
And get like 2 or 3 teaspoons of it and put it in a pantyhose. Throw it in your filter, and that'll be enough to give the shrimp enough calcium for them to molt. Because they got to be able to molt, and then they eat their shell, so they can keep that hard shell.
Yeah, that's neat.
And I started out with 50 of these. I bought 50 off of Amazon. And for 50 of them, it was like, I think with shipping, it was like $50.
Okay.
So I got 50 of these little guys, and then that quickly turned it into several hundred. I ordered these a couple of months ago, and the population has completely exploded. You have to be careful, like, what kind of fish you put in the tank with them. You don't want to put, like, rams and angelfish and different stuff like that. If you notice, I just have tetras in here. So you want to go with little itty bitty fish with small mouths that aren't going to actually predate on these shrimp. Even the tetras may eat the babies, but no, for the most part, if you keep moss, like I got like a little patch of moss back there,
okay.
That's like their habitat. They like to have moss. So if you get some moss, a lot of the babies will live in that. And then what I'll do is I'll give you a quick tutorial of the difference between a male and a female, so you know how to sex them. That way, if you want to get into breeding yourself, and if you go to a pet store and buy them from a pet store, which I don't recommend. I recommend getting them off Amazon because they're cheaper. But this big red one right here is a male, okay? And these are just the baby fry, all the little ones right here. So what we're looking for is a shrimp about this size, and it'll have a little orange stripe on its back. This one right here is a female. Here we go. So here's a female. If you look on, if you can get a, it's the one on that leaf right there.
Okay.
It's the one on top of that leaf. She went down though. She's down on the ground. To the left. Here, I'll put my finger over here.
Okay. Okay, in the back.
Okay, if you notice, on the top of her tail, like on the back of her back, there's like a little orange spot. It's called a saddle. And only the female have a saddle. And basically what the female do is they mate with the male, and then they go and they bury themselves underneath the sand. And then about 30 days later, they emerge with quite a few babies.
So when you ordered from Amazon, were you able to tell them I want X amount of females or males? Or
No. I just ordered a 50 count bag, and they were kind enough to ship a mixture of the males and the females in the bag. And I got a couple of females and a couple of males. And let's see if we can get one with a more pronounced saddle. Here we go. That's perfect. This one right here. You can really, really see the orange on her back.
Right.
So, you see that big orange? That little orange thing that's right there on her back?
Mm-hmm.
She'll come and get on my finger. They're not scared. There we go. All right. Let's see if you can pick that saddle up.
Can you bring her up to the top?
I gotta get her in the light seat so you can see it in the light.
Okay. See, it's perfect.
All right.
Very cool.
There's another one right here.
they're everywhere. All coming up.
They're everywhere, man. They're not hard to find, and that's great because the more females you have, the more babies you're gonna get, and then the more shrimp you're gonna have, and pretty soon you're gonna have to start giving these away because then they'll be competing for food and there'll be nothing left. So if you do. Mike, if you ever want to start your own shrimp tank, I got shrimp for you if you want some. You won't even have to pay for them. I'll give them to you.
That's sweet. Appreciate that. I was trying to get my daughter. She ended up getting a little tank and for a beta.
And it was freshwater.
It was a little freshwater tank, but she ended up giving it away. And I was thinking about turning it into a saltwater little nano, but then I was like, no, because I already have... I don't want to keep getting tanks and buying tanks. And this tank right here, it's a 125 or?
It's a 125.
What's this one
over here? I see
one over there.
127.
125.
Which one is what? Okay. This is the low-tech tank, the one that's not running CO2 on it. Made a few mistakes on this one. I wanted some bigger fish, like I wanted some big fish, and I was looking online to find fish that would be safe in a planted tank that were South American cichlids. So I got this right here, this firemouth cichlid. It's just pretty big fish. He's hiding right now. Let me see if I can find his friend. There goes his friend back there swimming. And you guys, the tank's not dirty. I just did a water change on it, and I cleaned out the filter pads, and so it's got a lot of debris and particles in the water right now. But that's not the star of the show. He's kind of creeped out right now because I don't bother them too much back here. So we're talking, and I think it's got him shy. But I got an extremely huge fish in here, and it's a chocolate cichlid.
He's about
a foot. He's about a foot long.
So let's see where this guy is.
So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go get some food, and the only thing that will make him come out is probably gonna be some food.
Did you see it?
Yeah, it was right there.
All right, you gotta scoot back, buddy, so he'll come out.
So you do a mixture of pellets and the flake?
Well, the thing is, the pellet size on this has to be big enough. It has to be big enough to feed the bigger fish. Flakes aren't really going to give them enough nutrition. So I feed them, I feed both. I'm hoping that maybe he'll see everybody eat and then decide to come on over here. Yeah, they're spooked right now.
Yeah, I'm right on top of the tank.
There he goes.
Oh, crap. Not kidding.
And that fish is the most harmless large cichlid that you can purchase. They're very peaceful. He doesn't really get along with anybody. His name is Biggie Smalls. That's his nickname. I nicknamed him Biggie Smalls.
He's chilling.
He's not afraid of me. He knows that when he sees me, it's food time.
Doesn't like my camera.
Yeah. He's camera shy. He's not food shy though. He loves food.
And like with these, this is the low tech tank, right? So, yeah. Like, do you do big water changes on this tank every week or?
I do the same thing. Like with the reef tank, I just every week I do water changes. I don't do very big water changes in here anymore. I know the tank looks dirty as hell right now, but. I changed out the filter pads, and I got rid of all the filter,
mm-hmm.
and it had a lot of dirt and gunk and buildup in it. And I did that this morning. I should have waited until after you came over, but
that's cool.
I noticed that the filter was clogged and it wasn't running, so I don't want the fish to not have any oxygen. I've added a few more Anubis to the tank. So there's a little bit more leaf growth right here.
When I started off with fish tanks, I started with, you know, fresh water. I didn't even really think about reef too much. But could you throw like those African chelids up in here or?
African cichlids? Well, African cichlids do better in like higher pH water. And these are South American fish and fish from Asia. So they like a little bit of tannins. This water doesn't have any tannins in it, but they like a little bit of softer side. They'll do fine up till about 7, but if you put African cichlids in here, their health is gonna decline and they won't live that long because they're used to living in like 8.0 pH, just like saltwater fish. Just like with the fish on the tank on your right, the Dutch tank with the shrimp in it, it's like a 7.0, 6.8 tank. So they really don't like hard water. But there's lots of South American cichlids though. There's lots of them. The only thing about cichlids is you have to be very careful, like who you pick. For tank mates, because if you get that fish, you're really only limited to that kind of fish, and maybe something else is compatible. Like I have corys and I have these demons, these tiger barbs, and I have some gouramis in here, and if I had you know, any of the other kind of South American cichlids other than like fire mouse or that big chocolate cichlid that I got in there, they'd probably get eaten or harassed to death.
Dude, it's cool.
Yeah, he's huge. My wife actually wanted him and I was like, I can't get that looks like an Oscar. I can't put that in there. And she was like, well, let's ask. And I looked it up on my phone and I Googled it and they said that that's the most gentle South American cichlid you can get. Now, I am suffering because I have South American cichlids in here. Those fire mouths, they're tearing up the bed, the substrate bed, and they're basically rooting out my plants, which are preventing them from growing. Now the plants on the driftwood are doing fine, and these swords and the tiger lotuses are all doing great, but anything that grows in the ground and stays like low, if any kind of piece of food goes in there, they're real violent. They'll go through there and they'll like chew it out, and it's causing my plants to die that are on the bottom. So it was a bad choice to purchase them, but at the same time I kind of like them. Check this one out. This is a gourami, and he's right up there at the top. They're kind of like beta fish, but they're in the gourami family. They get really, really colorful. Those are new. I just got them not too long ago. I got that's a male, because you can see how the colors are. And then behind him over there in the back, that's a female. So I have a couple of females and I got one male, because you can't put two males or two or more males in there, because they'll kill each other. They'll end up getting into fights unless your tank is big enough. It's okay for me to have.
This is a big tank though.
Maybe two of them in here, but I didn't want to do that. I just didn't want any kind of fighting.
Cause this is a 125, right?
Yeah, it's a parallel 125. I'm thinking about taking this tank and moving it up against this wall. My friend at work is just now getting into fish tanks, and
sweet.
I'm gonna give him this tank.
Nice.
For $100.
Oh yeah.
It's a good deal, right?
Oh yeah, bull front.
Yeah.
What size bull front is it?
72. It's a used tank. I got it from Craigslist.
Oh, that's cool, man.
I got it running on my canister filter, and then I did a 3D background.
So what kind of canister filter is this?
One of the cheap ones at Petco. I got it for $100. I was like $80 on sale. But the driftwood's still like leaching out tannins and whatnot. But this is the one that I had the self-fed mollies in there. Unfortunately, they didn't make it.
And you did a video on how to make this, so go check that out.
The background? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I made the 3D background for it.
Because I know even some people on saltwater are doing these 3D backgrounds.
Yeah, the one with, to make a saltwater 3D background is different, because you got to use basically like Marco's dry rock, or the dry rock from Bulk Reef Supply, and then you got to crush it up and like put it into small little rocks, and you use spray foam, and you put spray foam. Put the rocks inside of the spray foam while it's wet, and then you put rock salt. You get a whole bunch of rock salt and for the texture, and you put it in there, and that's pretty much all. And then you cover it with a aragonite sand. You take aragonite sand, like you put in the bottom of the aquarium, and that way once you put it in the aquarium, it can grow coralline algae and different stuffs on it.
Well, we're going to go ahead and end this video here. Appreciate you guys having us over, watching all these tanks. Awesome tanks. This is one of the tanks with the chocolate, what was it, chocolate what?
Chocolate cichlids.
Chocolate cichlids, and then the high-tech tank over here. So this is the high-tech, looking sweet with all the shrimp.
And I appreciate you coming over, and I appreciate everybody subscribing to Mike's channel, and I'd appreciate it if you guys would come over and check out my channel too. I have a channel going. That way you can kind of keep tabs on how these tanks are going.
Yep.
I plan on doing a massive trim over the next 2 weeks and kind of getting everything filled in and getting it thicker. And then, yes, I know some of you plant experts know that this is growing out of control.
It looks cool to me.
I'm gonna cut it down and replant it and get the carpet going. And but yeah, thank you for watching Mike's videos, and I appreciate it if you come and check out mine as well.
So the link and everything will be in the description. Thanks for watching. You guys take care.